Muito bom dia. Um prazer estar aqui neste segundo dia do Encontro de Ciência. Algo que começa a ser uma tradição aqui em Portugal. E hoje temos aqui esta sessão plenária número 4, que é a Ciência em Portugal para uma Europa mais global. E temos a honra de ter a presença de alguns ilustres convidados, o Ministro de Estado da Economia e da Transição Digital, Dr. Pedro Sousa Vieira. Temos algumas intervenções convidadas, Alexandra Cunha, Joint Nature Conservation Committee, UK. Temos o Miguel Belhão, que é o CEO do Air Center, o Tiago Rebelo, que está via Zoom. Temos o reitor da Universidade de Aga Khan, o Firoz Razul, o encerramento desta sessão será pelo ministro, o Sr. Ministro dos Negócios Estrangeiros, por vídeo, o Dr. Augusto Santos Silva. Antes de passar ao Sr. Ministro da Economia, gostaria de dizer que hoje nós vivemos um momento em que a ciência representa uma esperança para o momento que nós todos vivemos, um momento, digamos, de aflição social, e com expectativas todos olham para a ciência para conseguir respostas. E o facto é que, no conforto, quando nós estivemos confinados, desde março, nestes 4, 5, 6 meses, no conforto dos nossos lares, nós vimos substituídos os aqueles ícones da televisão mais populares pelos novos atores, que são os nossos cientistas. E projetamos neles a esperança da solução, de arranjarmos uma solução, conseguirmos uma solução para este problema que vivemos e projetarmos, de alguma forma, um futuro em que a ciência hoje tem um papel fundamental na construção do país. Vimos isto e continuamos a ver como os comitês científicos a assessorar os governos, algo inédito. Vemos, como referi, os novos atores nos mídia em que dão confiança às tomadas de decisão política. Mas vemos essencialmente isto e a resposta da ciência na expectativa de construirmos uma agenda absolutamente transformadora a nível social para o nosso país e no contexto europeu. E é preciso algumas visões estratégicas para o país e, em particular, para algumas áreas que relacionam a nossa interação como seres humanos com o planeta. Se, de alguma forma, um vírus nos uniu todos em torno da procura de uma solução, é um facto que temos outras soluções para procurar nesta relação instável entre a interação que nós fazemos com o planeta, explorando recursos limitados e que colocamos em causa a nossa sustentabilidade. Eu, como representante e como responsável da Agência Espacial Portuguesa, tenho a dizer que também no espaço há essa esperança e há esta solução e há esta resposta. Diria que a construção, iniciada em 2018 com a Estratégia Nacional para o Espaço e pragmatizada com a concretização de um projeto já antigo, que é a Agência Espacial Portuguesa, leva-nos a crer que temos as condições, numa época e numa era de convergência tecnológica e, se calhar, também de necessidade da procura de novas soluções, novas respostas, construir uma agenda em que o espaço é, com certeza, um dos fatores de resposta que nós precisamos. E olhamos para este setor com alguma perspectiva, alguma esperança de que, aproveitando exatamente este contexto e esta convergência tecnológica, consigamos construir uma agenda industrial, uma agenda de inovação também para o espaço. É importante referir que, no contexto da nossa localização, com este imenso oceano que representa um enorme potencial bloqueado ainda, Portugal deve ter uma resposta concertada a nível internacional e uma resposta em que o espaço e as ferramentas que dele resultam possam constituir também uma perspectiva para o nosso país, colocar-se como uma nação espacial e dar uma resposta também neste setor, combatendo e percebendo eventualmente melhor a interação e a sustentabilidade dos nossos ecossistemas e construindo modelos de previsão. Gostava-vos de deixar esta palavra sobre o espaço, porque representa, entre outros, um dos pilares também da recuperação económica que o nosso país está comprometido. Gostava agora de passar aqui a palavra ao Sr. Ministro de Estado, Dr. César Vieira, para nos dar um pouco, para partilhar os seus pensamentos sobre aquilo que pensa ser a resposta da ciência para estes problemas que nós vivemos atualmente e também, obviamente, num contexto muito mais alargado, o contexto europeu, e ligado, obviamente, ao plano de recuperação económica. Sr. Ministro.
Bom dia. Cumpridas as boas práticas da higienização, eu queria cumprimentar os poucos presentes neste enorme auditório e aqueles outros bastante mais abundantes, creio, que nos acompanham em casa ou à distância. Falar de ciência em Portugal para uma Europa mais global implica colocar essa questão em contexto. Uma Europa global é um conceito absolutamente autoevidente. Eu diria mesmo que a Europa inventou a globalização. E a Europa inventou a globalização quando começou a assentar a sua atividade económica nos ganhos conquistados pela ciência e pela tecnologia. Foi a capacidade de mobilizar conhecimento e de o transportar para atividades económicas e outras que levou a Europa, nos últimos 5 séculos, a conquistar um lugar central e a construir um planeta verdadeiramente globalizado. A partir da Idade dos Descobrimentos, assentando na ciência do conhecimento dos oceanos, da navegação, do conhecimento e da observação do espaço, da aquisição de conhecimentos cada vez maiores do ponto de vista químico, físico e na sua transposição para a atividade produtiva, a Europa conheceu a capacidade de integrar um planeta que até aí vivia relativamente isolado e de criar um sistema económico verdadeiramente global. A liderança económica global da Europa nunca terá estado tão evidente como no final do século XIX, no início do século XX, quando fomos capazes de, a partir do conhecimento e da ciência que se foi desenvolvendo, transpor isso para tecnologias que transformaram o modo de produzir, que aumentaram brutalmente a capacidade de ter bens físicos à disposição das populações e, nesse aspecto, criar uma era de grande prosperidade, de criação de excedentes que foram reinvestidos na melhoria da vida dos cidadãos. O século XX foi seguramente muito difícil, mas chegámos ao seu final numa situação em que a Europa vivia num contexto praticamente ideal. A liderança tecnológica que tinha atingido permitia-lhe gerar excedentes suficientes para garantir à população europeia níveis de bem-estar que provavelmente nunca foram atingidos na história da humanidade. Qualidade e segurança alimentar e segurança de abastecimento alimentar que ultrapassou as necessidades históricas de alimentar a população, segurança do meio ambiente com qualidade do ar, da água que bebemos e daquela que rejeitamos para o meio ambiente, capacidade de assegurar saúde e educação a toda a população. Todo este nível de bem-estar assentou na liderança tecnológica que a Europa adquiriu ao longo dos séculos. E neste momento, a verdade é que sentimos todos isso, tem consequências económicas, tem consequências sociais e tem consequências políticas, que a liderança nas novas tecnologias começa a escapar à Europa. Do ponto de vista das novas tecnologias digitais, aqueles que dominam a atividade económica estão do outro lado do Oceano Atlântico e cada vez mais na Ásia. E nesse sentido, importa à Europa recolocar a questão do seu posicionamento neste sistema económico global. Se não conseguir assegurar a capacidade de produzir bens, conhecimento, bens tangíveis e intangíveis, que possam assegurar estes níveis de bem-estar, é toda a concepção da forma como vivemos em sociedade que fica posta em causa. E uma vez mais, só o conhecimento e a ciência podem assegurar à Europa um nível de prosperidade compatível com as aspirações dos seus cidadãos. E, nesse sentido, importa refletir bem de que forma conseguimos traduzir o conhecimento científico que vai continuando a ser produzido na Europa em bens e serviços que possam encontrar uma colocação no mercado e que possam assegurar este nível de bem-estar económico que se traduz depois em bem-estar social, ambiental e mesmo político. E, nesse sentido, é muito importante que, no contexto das circunstâncias em que vivemos, a Europa, para responder a uma crise económica que decorre da pandemia da Covid-19, tenha feito dois passos absolutamente essenciais. O primeiro passo é perceber que a dimensão desta crise económica exige uma resposta económica que não está ao alcance de qualquer Estado europeu isoladamente considerado. E por isso a decisão mais importante dos últimos tempos é mesmo esta ideia de mobilizar a própria credibilidade, a própria solidez da União Europeia para levantar fundos no mercado que possam sustentar um programa de recuperação económica para todo o continente de uma escala inédita na história da União Europeia. Esse é o primeiro grande passo. Mas o segundo grande passo, praticamente tão crítico como o primeiro, é a ideia de dedicar o investimento que se tornado possível por estes recursos assim mobilizados para vencer alguns desafios cruciais para a nossa prosperidade futura. Em lugar de pura e simplesmente fazer um programa de estímulo económico que seja orientado para dinamizar a atividade económica, se quiserem aquela velha receita que o Keynes ilustrava com a ideia de abrir buracos para depois tapar, cria emprego e atividade económica e por si só ajuda a sair da crise. A Europa não se limitou a isso. Depois de ter mobilizado os recursos, disse que estes recursos vão ser aplicados em algo que vai ter um estímulo económico imediato, porque dinamiza a atividade económica, mas que vai ser focado na construção da nossa prosperidade futura, investindo em fatores críticos para o nosso bem-estar e a nossa competitividade a prazo. Por um lado, para conseguir compatibilizar esta ideia de crescimento económico com a necessidade de proteger o nosso planeta, a diversidade da vida do nosso planeta e a capacidade de sustentar o nível de recursos que dele extraímos. A transição climática, que há de consagrar 37%, que há de estar consagrado 37% dos recursos do Plano de Recuperação Europeu, visam precisamente assegurar que a forma como vivemos, como consumimos, como produzimos, é compatível com os desafios da neutralidade carbónica em meados deste século. O investimento na transição digital, corresponde à compreensão de que, para podermos ser mais eficientes, não apenas na forma como utilizamos os nossos recursos e os reutilizamos, mas também na forma como produzimos para o mercado, exige um investimento muito grande nas tecnologias digitais. Não apenas na adaptação dos nossos sistemas, das nossas empresas, das nossas organizações às tecnologias digitais produzidas por outros, mas na capacidade de desenvolvermos autonomamente na Europa uma nova geração de tecnologias digitais, sobretudo orientadas para a digitalização da indústria. E a terceira nota, também muito significativa, é de perceber que é à volta da cooperação europeia e na mobilização comum dos recursos humanos, científicos e financeiros que a Europa tem, que haveremos de conseguir dar este passo. Temos, portanto, os recursos. Temos o objetivo, que é de assegurar esta construção da prosperidade futura. E temos a consciência de que o caminho que queremos produzir vai exigir uma imensa captação de conhecimento e a capacidade de, a partir dele, transformar os nossos sistemas económicos. Pensem nisto. Tornar a Europa um continente neutro em emissões de gases com efeitos de estufa em 2050, pode-se fazer de duas maneiras. Ou regressando ao confinamento imediato e à cessação de toda a atividade económica, ou adaptando a forma como produzimos e consumimos os recursos. E este é o caminho que a Europa escolheu traçar. E para esse é necessário conceber, industrializar e distribuir em grande quantidade produtos, tecnologias cuja forma de produção nos permite alcançar este objetivo. E essa mobilização é absolutamente crucial. E aqui voltamos ao papel de Portugal neste contexto. Na nossa economia, no nosso país, a capacidade de colocar o conhecimento ao serviço da economia é mais crítica do que nunca. Trata-se não apenas de participar neste processo europeu de que falava, mas de, ao fazê-lo, darmos um salto significativo na forma como o nosso país se apresenta ao mundo na sua produção. Se quiserem, trata-se da aceleração de um processo que está em curso. Desde há duas décadas, o país investiu significativamente na modernização e na criação de um sistema científico e tecnológico verdadeiramente moderno, competitivo, aberto ao mundo e cada vez mais capaz de ser avaliado e de concorrer na produção de conhecimento com outros números. Isso também só é possível porque, desde a implantação da democracia, resolvemos investir significativamente na qualificação dos nossos recursos humanos. E tendo ainda um atraso relativamente aos nossos congêneres europeus, podemos dizer com confiança que fomos provavelmente o país que mais progressos fez nestes últimos anos. E a conjugação destes efeitos, investimento na qualificação, investimento no sistema científico e tecnológico, já trouxe resultados tangíveis para a nossa vida económica. Na última década, Portugal cresceu muito significativamente o valor das suas exportações, cresceu sobretudo diversificando os produtos e bens e serviços que exporta, cresceu porque os produtos que exporta são cada vez mais tecnologicamente complexos e por isso geram mais valor para os seus produtores, e esse percurso é aquele que devemos de prosseguir. E o desafio que eu lanço num encontro com a ciência e a tecnologia em Portugal, como Ministro da Economia, é que sejamos capazes agora de dar o próximo e decisivo passo. É conseguir aquilo que, na verdade, mais crítico é nesta altura. É a capacidade de traduzir este conhecimento em processos e produtos que transformem que a forma como Portugal se especializa economicamente. É estar verdadeiramente próximo das nossas empresas. É articular e investir naquelas instituições que fazem o interface entre a produção de conhecimento e a produção de bens e serviços para o mercado. As nossas empresas são francamente inovadoras. Aliás, se Portugal se qualifica tão bem no Innovation Scoreboard da União Europeia, como país fortemente inovador, pela primeira vez o ano passado, tal se deve sobretudo à percentagem de pequenas e médias empresas inovadoras. Elas estão disponíveis para mudar processos, para desenvolver produto. Mas precisamos mesmo que todo o nosso sistema científico e tecnológico se prepare para duas coisas. Uma é falar mais de perto com o nosso tecido empresarial. Resolver problemas concretos em termos de produto, em termos de processo e colocar a capacidade e as competências desenvolvidas ao serviço de respostas concretas para chegar ao mercado. Transformar aquilo que se percebe em produto. Ou então ajudar as empresas a resolver problemas com que se confrontam. E esta proximidade é crítica. A segunda nota, obviamente, é também fazê-lo num contexto cada vez de maior abertura e cooperação internacional. Sabemos que a capacidade de cooperarmos com outras instituições é a forma de progredir na inovação hoje em dia. E por isso seriam esses os dois desafios que eu lançava à comunidade científica e tecnológica. Nós estamos num continente, numa união política, que corresponde ao maior mercado do mundo, que corresponde também aos países onde os níveis de produtividade mais elevados são. Queremos preservar os níveis de bem-estar que a Europa tem proporcionado aos seus concidadãos. Temos os recursos necessários para alinhar agora esses objetivos de longo prazo com as competências e capacidades que temos. Em Portugal podemos ser protagonistas. Esse protagonismo agora depende cada vez mais de falar de perto e de responder às necessidades do mercado. E como Ministro da Economia, estarei sempre a interpelar a comunidade científica e tecnológica no nosso país para que se coloquem verdadeiramente ao serviço do nosso tecido empresarial. É nas respostas concretas que forem capazes de dar aos problemas que as empresas se colocam, é na capacidade que tiverem de ter a curiosidade para os problemas que no dia-a-dia elas identificam, que seremos capazes de dar mais um salto neste processo. Muito obrigado a todos e muito bom trabalho. Bom dia.
Muito obrigado, Sr. Ministro. Dar simplesmente aqui, eventualmente, uma nota. Portanto, Portugal inovador, traduzir este conhecimento em capacidade tecnológica e colocá-lo ao serviço da economia. I think now we should switch to English, because we have now some interventions from our panelists. I will ask for Alexandra Cunha. I think she will join us by Zoom, right? So Alexandra Cunha belongs to the Joint Nature Conservation Committee in UK. So I think, Alexandra, I know you are there. Okay. Hello, Alexandra. The floor is yours.
Thank you. Good morning, dear colleagues and participants. I can't see how many participants are in this plenary session, but I hope everyone is in good spirits and with a hot tea or coffee in hand. I would like to start by acknowledging the Science 2020 Organizing Committee for inviting me to participate in the conference and send my apologies for not being able to be there in person. As you can imagine, I would have loved to be in Lisbon at the conference center and meeting everyone in person. I also would like to say that the views expressed here today are my own and not my employer, JNCC. After I realized the topic of my plenary session was science in Portugal for a more global Europe, I panicked. My science expertise is very specific and is all about seagrass ecology, nature conservation, and marine protected areas. So how could I possibly contribute with any ideas to such a tremendous task? So I decided to ask some colleagues for help. After our mean brainstorming session, the word came out, whatever you want to speak about, Alexandra, do it with passion. Well, my passion are seagrasses, and nobody here wants to hear me about speaking about seagrasses today. So I thought I would reflect on my own experience and the process of becoming a scientist in Portugal and in Europe. What worked well and what could have worked better? And what I want to do today is to share with you some ideas that I think could help promote the Portuguese scientists in Europe. Some of these ideas are not new, and I recognize that a tremendous effort has already been made in Portugal, with many research centers hosting and networking with the best research centers in Europe. At present, scientists in Europe and all over the world face a tremendous challenge. Our word has been mistrusted and often twisted. An example of this has been the global disbelief about the human impact on climate change. And now we are experiencing it again with COVID-19 and the pandemic. We have seen scientific advice being ignored over and over by decision makers, science being politicized and not reaching the public the way it should. We have seen scientists struggling to put together enough good evidence and communicate it properly. We need to make people trust in the science community, and we scientists need to be more confident in our role in benefiting society. So, what can we do in Portugal to get into a better position? I think we need to improve the way we train scientists in Portugal. I know that with the implementation of the Bologna program, the way scientists are trained in Portugal is changing, but we need to do better. I thought about my own experience growing as a scientist. I'm very grateful for having had the most inspiring teachers at school and professors at uni. I was delivered the most comprehensive and the best quality information about the mysteries of biology while studying at Portuguese universities. And that was the kind of education that allowed me to shine while doing my PhD in an American university. Yet, I was not prepared to start working and enter the labor market, including academia. Nobody taught me how to use science to get an impact in society and ultimately change the world for better. I think a key point to promote science in Portugal into going more global is to accelerate a change in teaching paradigm at universities. We need to give scientists more tools to get them ready to start working when they finish uni. We need to teach maybe less content and deliver more behavior competency-based learning. We need to empower students and they need to finish their training more confident they can do a job. For example, we need more training at project and people management while at school. Most of us scientists had to manage projects, European projects and FCT projects included, without any previous formal project management training. And it was not easy, to say the least. Young scientists need to have proper access to personal development, career strategy, and coaching programs. Having studied and worked abroad, I found a staggering difference between my colleagues at work in England and when I had to recruit for projects while in Portugal. I'm always in awe when I see my young colleagues just recently coming out of English universities and so ready to dive into large pieces of work with all confidence. Portugal needs to provide proper training in science communication and influencing if we want to make an impact and to be heard. Science funders in Portugal need to support more citizen science programs. There are good examples of citizen science projects in Portugal, which shows that the Portuguese society is hungry for information and collaboration opportunities. But abroad, I see another level of society engagement, and the numbers of people participating in citizen science projects is enormous. A lot of the projects I've seen have thousands of people gathering the most diverse information and data to feed databases and form the basis of solid evidence. And this takes me to the next topic. Portugal could invest more in data gathering, organizing and managing data to support decisions and solid expertise judgments. The use of strong evidence is paramount to the way scientific advice is delivered and perceived. We need clear and transparent information to engage with decision makers and have their support and trust. In Europe, there's a growing hunger for scientific evidence and well-managed data hubs, and Portugal could develop that area of expertise. Funders, research foundations, and governments need to invest more in evidence gathering, data management and quality assessment, and staff training. Evidence databases are fundamental, and yet is a large shortage for funding for it in Portugal. Not only funding the creation of databases, training scientists and paying people to manage those databases. And speaking about money, it is important that scientists have access to proper careers. If science is to go more European, Portugal needs to look deeper at the scientific human fabric and support scientist workers. Scientists need to have access to a career, to personal development opportunities, to a healthy family work balance, and to a fair and behavior competency based performance assessment. In previous sessions this week, I heard that not all PhD holders will find jobs in academia, and I certainly agree we are not all fit for academia. We need more business hiring scientists, but also government bodies. But we need to train scientists better for that kind of jobs, and also show business owners and government bodies how scientists can help them do a better job. I also heard Portugal is good at doing omelets without eggs. I say, we could do much better omelets if we actually had the eggs, as all scientists working abroad can attest. In summary, my 2 pence for a road book on how to make science in Portugal more ready to go global are: change aspects of scientific training, making scientists more ready for the labor market by focusing on a wider set of behavior competencies, not only the content, supporting more and better training in science communication, promote large and sustainable in time citizen science projects, fund evidence gathering and the creation of databases so scientists can use it to provide advice and solid evidence. And finally, Portugal need to nurture their scientists and boost their morale if a greater impact in Europe science is the aim. Thank you so much for your attention and have a lovely day.
Thank you, Alexandra. So I will make some notes about Alexandra's presentations. And I took my notes here. Tremendous efforts has been done in science in Portugal. Also, the ignorance of the decision makers for the evidences presented by the scientific community. Key point to promote science in BT is the training in science communication. And one note that I took that will bridge the intervention from Miguel Bellot, investing in data gathering and training, a scientific database. So Miguel, this is your turn now. Miguel Bellot is the Air Center CEO. And I start to tease you, Miguel, about this remark that Alexandra did about to have more data, to have more knowledge. So how the Air Center, we will contribute for that.
Thank you, Ricardo. Well, thank you very much. Thank you for this kind invitation. Good morning, everybody. I got a presentation. I will deal about this topic, but I'll, in my presentation, I will discuss some key enables to make more global Portuguese science, how Portugal can help to make a more global Europe. We identify different topics like address global issues, multidisciplinary approach, international collaboration was also stressed by the Minister of Economy, artificial intelligence and data science. But I want to be practical, not be theoretical. Then I want to present three particular cases of global problems where Portugal is already, Portuguese science and technology is already playing an important role trying to solve this problem. In the short term, on the COVID, in a mid-term, climate change, and in a long-term, asteroid impact. I want to go to see how Portugal is contributing to those three problems, and then I would like to end with some conclusions. Well, the question we have today in this panel is how science in Portugal may contribute towards a more global Europe. And we can turn this question, as Professor Helena Cañao did, is that how we can make the Portuguese science more global. And for that, as I said before, first, we should tackle global issues. We should tackle global problems. There are global issues. There is more and more interconnected activities. Those global problems cannot be addressed with a single discipline. We need a multidisciplinary approach. For instance, for climate change, we have to combine atmospheric science with geophysics, with space, with oceanography. The same way that a single discipline cannot solve this problem, a single country cannot do it. We need international collaboration, was stressed by the Minister of Economy. And international collaboration is one of the key aspects of the Air Center. I'm the CEO of the Air Center, and we are joining 15 countries along the Atlantic to deal with all this problem. And this international collaboration is a key issue to make the Portuguese science more global. And then artificial intelligence and data sciences. We are collecting a lot of data. We have to collect more data. And the combination of this data with artificial intelligence is a key enable to generate new products and services. Was also mentioned by the Minister of Economy. He put two challenges to the Portuguese science and technology: to be able to generate new products and services, and to be in international collaboration. Both things can be dealt with those combination of Earth observation data with artificial intelligence. But let's go to the three examples. I want to go to those three examples to see how Portugal is already, in many aspects, global in science and technology. Let's go to the short term. In the very short term, we only have one challenge, is the COVID. This is the short-term challenge, and Portugal already have good answers to this. We have to stress, for instance, the project of the respirator did by Seye at University of Minho. This is a unique case where in 45 days, new product was generated, and this product was made global, because this product was sold to Brazil, Angola, Mozambique, and other countries. I mean, Portugal is already global on that, and we have to put this emphasis. Also, at the Air Center, we generate a new project called COVID Observatory, and by using data from the Sentinels, we did a daily update of the water quality, the air quality during the pandemic. I mean, this is, there are already some important global contribution to Portuguese industry and, science and technology to this problem. Let's go to the second, to the midterm. In the midterm, the main problem we face is climate change. COVID is an eclipse. It's eclipsing the problem we were dealing, which is climate change and all their related effects. We have extreme weather events, we have sea level rise, we have a loss of biodiversity, we have ocean acidification. All those are real problems that we have to face in the midterm. And also Portugal is very active in that. Portugal is very active because what we need is to check and to have a complete observation of the Earth. The European Union launched the Green Deal to tackle this problem. And within the Green Deal, there is a project by European Union and European Space Agency, which is called Digital Twin Earth. Digital Twin Earth is to get a model in virtual of the behavior of the Earth, a complete model. We better call it Digital Twin Ocean, because the biggest part of the planet is ocean. This Digital Twin Earth is going to be a tool. It's going to be a tool for policymakers to take decisions, but it's also a tool to generate new products and services, as the minister said this morning. And Portugal is already very active there. It's already very active in different lines. I mean, the Portuguese Space Agency, led by Ricardo, they have one of the four main priorities is the digital planet, to promote the use of Earth observation for day-to-day application. This is very close to the citizen. This is the way to improve the life of the citizen with this digital planet project. In addition, in collaboration with the Portugal Space Agency, the Earth Center, we are promoting a constellation of satellites called the Atlantic Constellation. This is a constellation of satellites to monitor with an unprecedented frequency the health of our oceans. This will help for the digital twin Earth, and that will help to collect all these data that we need, which deal later on with artificial intelligence can give solutions for fisheries, for coastal erosion, for aquaculture. And this is done, those global views, it's very much pushed forward by Portugal, which we are in a unique situation because, you know, Portugal is now co-president of the European Space Agency. Portugal will lead the European Union with the president next year. And Portugal will be also president of Eureka, the largest innovation network with nearly 50 countries. And those global challenges will be priority and will put Portugal in a leading role in this global issue, will help in Europe and Portugal to be more global. And we also look to long term to talk to a new topic. In the long term, what challenges we're facing? There is a challenge which is there, and which is a possible asteroid impact with the Earth. This is a long-term issue which may happen, but is this a real problem, or this is just an excuse for Hollywood movies? And well, in fact, it's a real problem. If you look to the, I don't know if the laser worked, but I'm colorblind like Ricardo, I think I'm very bad to do, but you look to the graph on the top, on the right, how many asteroids could collide with the Earth? Of the order of 10 kilometers, a dozen. Those is the one who killed dinosaurs. It was about 16 kilometers size. It's about a dozen. But if you go to 1 kilometer, it's already 1,000. If you go to a few hundred meters, we have 100,000 asteroids of about 300 meters. We call it city killers. Why city killers? Because the impact, the effect of this impact is 1,000 megatons. We'll destroy a city like New York and we'll create fat casualties of the order of a few million. And this is the problem because the big one, we know them, but those one, only 5% are known. 95% is unknown. And a smaller one, of the other 15 meters, there are millions. How frequent they impact the Earth? Those smaller ones, every day. Every day, small asteroids fall down on the Earth. There are a meter, a few meters. Those are, in summer, these meteors. We have shower of meteors. This is not a real problem. There is only an indirect risk. In the Cold War between the USSR and the United States, there were spy satellites detecting nuclear missile launches. And those meteors could be confused with a missile launch. And in fact, we were twice about to start a nuclear war because of those meteors. But in fact, per se, this is not a problem for us. The problem is when we go to higher sizes. In fact, this is the effect. If we go to 50 to 300 meters, it is something will happen 250 years. And it's an event like Tunguska. Tunguska is the last big one which fell down in 1908, about 100 years ago. Tunguska is in Siberia. Fortunately, it was a not-populated area. Only two people died because it was completely isolated area. If that would be in a big city, we'll be talking about different figures. But this is today the most worrying one. But if you go to higher sizes, for instance, for more than 10 kilometers, 6 billion casualties because whole life on Earth could be lost. Fortunately, that happens only once every 100 million. This is not very frequent. There are some proof of that. This is the Barrington crater in Arizona. Those are craters in Canada. Hundreds of asteroid impact year. This is the list of the well-known. There is one in China in 1490 with about 10,000 people killed. And 65 million years ago was the dinosaur one. Then the question is not if an asteroid will impact the Earth. The question is, when is the next one and how big it is? This is the main question. Well, in our files, the most dangerous we envisage is called Apophis. Apophis is the king, is the god of the cows, and Apophis was discovered recently. When it was discovered, there was a probability to kick the Earth in 2029. It's a 300 meter size, 20 million tons. It would impact a 50,000 kilometer per hour, generating a power of 1,000 megatons. New observations demonstrate that it will not impact the Earth in 2029. It will pass at a distance of 20,000 kilometers. 20,000 kilometers is very small. It's half the distance of the geostationary satellites. And there is an ellipse of error. This ellipse of error, it is depicted there, is very elongated. There are some places in this ellipse that we call keyhole. If the asteroid passes by this keyhole, because it will get in resonance, will come back every 7 years close to the Earth. If passed by this keyhole, will impact the Earth in 2036. The probability is 1 in 50,000. It's very low. It's not going to happen. But there are lotteries. The Christmas lottery, the probability to win is 1 in 100,000. If people play the lottery, I mean, we should avoid to play this lottery. This is the negative lottery we don't want to play. That means we need solution. We need science and technological solution for this problem. And Portugal is active in this. A Portuguese team, together with Swiss, France, Italy, and Spain, proposed a project to mitigate this. But let's have a look to what are the science solutions for that. There are different solutions. There is an instantaneous solution. There are long-term solutions and other funny solutions. Instantaneous, the US prefer, the America prefer, is an explosion. It's a nuclear bomb, a nuclear weapon. The European solution proposed by Portugal is a kinetic impact. Is to impact with a probe, with a spacecraft of about 100 kilos to move it. Why we don't like the explosions? First of all, launchers are very reliable, but still 3% of the launchers fail. If you put in Cape Canaveral, close to Miami, a nuclear bomb, and there is a 3% of probability to fail, to solve a problem of 1 in 50,000, the statistic doesn't work. Second, if you destroy the asteroid, you may create many small impacts. You may create grenade, kind of a bigger problem than the one you want to solve. That's why Europe and Portugal prefer the second solution, a kinetic impact, to impact and then move the trajectory, to deflect the asteroid. There are other solutions. There are put an electric engine on that with low thrust, put a solar sail, deploy a solar sail, and the solar wind will move it. There is another one, which is an ion beam laser system. The funniest one is the one proposed by Russia. The Russian professor Ivashkin is a well-known asteroid expert, proposed to paint the asteroid. If you paint the asteroid totally black or totally white, the effect of the sun photons move the trajectory with the Jarkovsky effect. That means just by painting, you can avoid that. Which is the problem of this long term? Is that you need 20 years to deflect. While the instantaneous, you may detect the asteroid too late, and you have no time to go to this one. Then kinetic impact is the most important one. Europe made a competition some years ago for ideas, how to deflect an asteroid. This competition was won by a team, as I said, where Portugal has a role together with Spain, Italy, Swiss, and France, and was a project called Don Quixote. The idea is to learn to deflect asteroids. You have to learn. The question is, the first time you have to deflect is not the first time you do it. You need to make exercises. And the exercise was two probes. When there are two probes launched together from the Earth, go back to the Earth 6 months later. One is called Sancho, the other one is called Hidalgo. Then the first one make a flyby of the Earth and go directly to the asteroids. Orbit the asteroids and characterize it. Gravity field, nutation, rotation, compact. And the second one, it's sent to Venus. Venus, with a flyby of Venus, you get high velocity and you impact the asteroid at a very high velocity. And then the other one get back and measures the deflection. our calculation, the one done by the scientists, is that with a 500 kilograms spacecraft, you can deflect 50 microns per second, a big asteroid. This is all you need. Only 50 microns per second you have to deflect to have it done. This is how the orbit around asteroid looks like. This is Tutatis, this is a real asteroid. And there is, the scientists, when you impact the asteroid, there is a big crater and a big mass will be ejected. This multiplies the effect of the impact kinetic change. If asteroid would be a billiard ball, there is an easy way to calculate. It's a physics problem of high school, but this mass ejected multiplies by factor beta. Scientists think that this beta factor can be 10, but this factor is a key calculation that we need to do in this type of projects. Okay, I would like to finish with a vignette I found in the press. This is a Congress of Dinosaur. It is, the speaker says, the frequency of a dinosaur killer impact is about 1 every 100 million years. And then in the audience, one said to the other, so why should we worry? Well, as conclusion, we firmly believe that to make Portugal more global and Europe more global, we need to deal with those global challenges in an international collaboration, in a multidisciplinary approach. And I just said, the role of Earth observation data combined with artificial intelligence and data science is going to be crucial for what I said before, to create products and services and to try to deal with these global challenges. Portugal is already global. I mean, it's already playing a critical role in global problems like COVID, like climate change, or like asteroid impact. I mean, we're already there, but we have to continue this line to take the challenges put by the Minister of Economy this morning, to make products and services and to be international. I would like to finish with an optimistic message. It's nothing more optimistic than Stephen Hawking. He said, we are just an advanced breed of monkeys on a minor planet of a very average star, but we can understand the universe, and that makes us very special. Thank you.
Thank you, Miguel. There are another dimensions, and this also the space debris. This is one of the topics that we, Portugal, we are also involved with, and of course with the knowledge and some programs together with the European Space Agency. So I wrote also here some notes, some remarks, some conclusions, Miguel. Space has the solutions to know more about our planets, our oceans, and interactions with our planets. Also the answers of space to planetary defense and the importance of the data science to improve our knowledge. Now, I think we have Tiago Rebelo. Tiago is a director of a department of CEIA, a research center in Matosinhos, north. So I think Tiago will join us by Zoom, right? Uh-huh. Okay, welcome, hello. Tiago.
Hello, so,
you have the floor, please.
Okay, thank you very much, Ricardo. Thank you for the kind introduction. First of all, good morning to everyone, which is there in the auditorium, but also to everyone which is listening at home. A welcome remark to my dear colleagues for this panel, and my apologies for not being able to join you there in Lisbon. Well, it's the times that we are living, and we need to accommodate it. And it's a good example how technology is disrupting and is making us all global. And diminishing the gap between ourselves. So first of all, I should start by saying that I'm absolutely astonished by the previous presentations. Miguel is absolutely right. We are already contributing to a global Europe from here, from Portugal, and I'll try to address that in my presentation as well. But Alexandra previously has also mentioned something which I loved, which is, we need to take care of our resources, and our resources, the best we have is our people. And I think for that, we need to generate the conditions. And the conditions, I'm not talking about salaries only, I'm talking about challenges. And for challenges, we need to work all together to face those challenges, which can be societal, which can be coming from outer places, like the asteroid impact that Miguel was mentioning. So I've divided my brief presentation, and I'll try to stick with the 15 minutes in three main topics. What is SAIA and what's our role? And our role here and the role of institutions like SAIA in bridging the gap between science, knowledge, and industry and economic value. And afterwards, I'll try to give a few examples on how I believe we are already, and by we, I mean our country, is already contributing in quite some areas to making Europe more global and to really develop products and services which have a knowledge base, but really have an economic impact down the road. And third and at last, I think we don't need recipes on how to deal with a post-pandemic world, but everyone has its views, and we have our views on how shall we face the opportunities that lie ahead of us, because there are opportunities. And the Minister of Economy this morning just mentioned the great initiative from Europe, which we as a country will have to take the challenge, we'll have to take the endeavor, and we'll have to organize ourselves, and we'll have to face the fact that we'll need to work like we never did before. We'll need to work together like we never did before. So I'll try to address these three topics. SAIA, a few examples, and then a few key words on how to deal with a post-pandemic world. So very briefly, SAIA is an innovation center, is an engineering center. We have more than 20 years of existence. We are one of the highest investors in the country in research and development. We have projects deployed across 10 countries. We have around 300 engineers, and we are up today the biggest employer of aerospace engineers here in the country. We have our headquarters in Porto, but we also have offices in Évora near the aeronautical cluster, and also in Brazil and in other parts of Europe. We work mainly in five different areas. We try to face, let's say, social, technology, and economic challenges from the perspective of these five different markets: the automotive, the mobility, the aeronautics, the ocean, and space. But there is one key word that lies in between all of this, which is sustainability. And sustainability is a word that perhaps is becoming too popular in the sense that everyone is using it. But when I talk about sustainability, I'm not only talking about the environment, I'm not only talking about our oceans, I'm not only talking about our planet, but I'm also talking about social sustainability and economic sustainability. So when we look at these five different areas, obviously we need to go carbon neutral, obviously we need to make our industries more competitive, but there is a trade-off. One, we cannot do one without the other, and there, certainly we cannot have both tomorrow, but we need to work towards it. So sustainability is what's common to all these five different areas. Then our role, and our role, even though quite simple to explain, is very difficult to actually do it. And our role is to bridge the gap between academia, between research centers, between science and knowledge with industry. And it's not the journey, it's not only from science and knowledge to industry. It's also a journey from that starts with challenges from industry. So it's not only science that needs to get close to industry, like we normally say, it's also industry that needs to get close to science. It's the industry that needs to understand as well that science is only a benefit. Knowledge is only something that can make our products and services better, and it's only something that can make our economy a more knowledge-based one with much more added value. So very simply, what we try to do is to lay in between research, we try to perform development and technology integration, we do a lot of engineering and product development, and then we partner, we spin off, we have startups for the industrialization of the commercialization. But the gap is really not only left to right, it's also right to left, it's also industry to science and science to industry. So I'll give you three examples on how scientific challenges and partnerships with universities and R&D centers generated products, which are now on the market and are now being deployed, but also three examples on how industry has challenged us and the academia and the science to make their products better and to help or develop their products. And then I'll have one last example, which is, and Miguel already mentioned, which is an example on how we have all together replied to a national emergency, to a global emergency, which was the COVID-19 pandemic, and how we developed this respirator, this ventilator in 45 days. So, first example, we were challenged a few years back by University of Azores and by a few marine biologists that wanted to monitor big marine animals. And they wanted to do it like no one has ever done it before. They wanted to do it in a non-invasive way, so they didn't want to hurt the animals. They wanted to do it without interfering with that behavior. And they wanted not only to monitor the animals, but also to monitor the ecosystem. And to monitor the ecosystem means to monitor the ocean, its acidification, its O2 presence, salinity, et cetera, et cetera. So more than just retrieving knowledge from the animals, we are actually using the animals as data mules. We are using the animals to collect data for us. And what we did is we developed this reusable marine tags, which is basically the red thing that you are seeing in the middle of the screen, which can go up to two kilometers depth, and which basically do their mission in a full passive way. They are attached to the animal in a non-invasive way. For the animal, it's like a fly on a horse. It doesn't feel, it doesn't know it's there. There is no alteration to its behavior. And when its mission ends, it comes to the surface, it communicates with the satellite, and it's retrieved. And as of today, I can say that most of the scientific documentaries that we are seeing in our televisions, from BBC, from National Geographic, is being recorded with these tags, is being recorded with 4K cameras, which are included on these small devices, and that we are selling for the niche market, not only for scientists and for the sake of knowledge, but also for ocean literacy. And we are getting images and information that we could never have retrieved other way. And this was a scientific challenge. It came from a scientist, and the engineers and the people that worked the technology made it so that it could work. And this is already a contribute towards, I would say, a more global Europe in a very niche market, but one that is very interesting because, to be fair, we know more about the moon than we know about the bottom of our oceans. And this is something that we need to change. And Miguel also mentioned the digital twin Earth project. I believe it's really about knowing more about our ocean, as most of our land, of our Earth, is ocean. The second example, it's about autonomous vehicles. And autonomous vehicles, I could have mentioned drones and their role in monitoring the territory or making agriculture smarter or monitoring our oceans and dealing with piracy, et cetera, et cetera. But I've decided not to talk about drones, but to talk about autonomous surface vehicles. Because there are multiple means on how to monitor the ocean, and definitely one can be satellites and Earth observation, and I'll mention that down the road. The other is in-situ observation, and in-situ observation needs also means on the water. It means on the water, if today we are already flying drones for most of our missions and monitoring the Earth and monitoring the different applications from the air, we need to start doing the same with vehicles in the ocean, with vehicles in the water, and this is one example of an autonomous surface vehicle that it's really dealing with bathymetry collection and data collection at the ocean bottom. And it's a fully electric vehicle, fully autonomous vehicle. And again, it came out of a challenge, which is at the intersection between science and industrial means. Now, the third one, and the minister mentioned the fact that Europe needs to become carbon neutral, and Portugal is ahead of that challenge, I should say, because we were one of the first countries in the world to have a charging electric grid, which started a few years back with the MOBI-E project, which then evolved, and multiple companies, including EFASEP, built a huge repository of products coming from that opportunity. But I believe that we need now to change from mobility management to sustainability management. So mobility is what we do when we need to get from place A to place B. But we are only going to go more green and to really change behaviors if we incentivize behavior changing. So what are we doing these days is we are basically putting a value on carbon. And if you are emitting too much carbon, you need to pay for it. Well, our concept is slightly different. If you are saving carbon, if you are sparing CO2 by making a green choice, if I'm walking, if I'm taking an electric car, if I'm taking an electric bike, if I take a bus instead of driving my diesel car, then I should be reimbursed. I should have a value on that. So we developed the AIR. The AIR is a sustainability platform, which is already in place, for example, in the city of Cascais, where we are giving prizes to citizens which have sustainable behaviors. And with that, we not only control the entire mobility grid, but we also incentivize decarbonization. We also incentivize green movements. And finally, three examples on industry challenging science. One, a pilot offshore underwater aquaculture for growing salmon in the middle of the Atlantic. This is a challenge that came from industry, from a big retail group here in Portugal, which basically understood that it would be perhaps possible to grow salmon not only in the fjords in Norway, but in the middle of the Atlantic. And there are technological and scientific challenges that need to be addressed, because in the middle of the Atlantic means 10 miles from the shore, 40 meters depth. So the systems needed to be fully autonomous. This was a pilot that was in place last year. The results were quite successful. And I believe this is a huge opportunity, again, for merging the gap between science and the industry with economic value, because Portugal is already one of the biggest consumers of salmon in the world, but this market is a very interesting one, and competing with Norway in this case would be certainly a differentiator in the high value markets. Then another challenge in this case from Embraer with the development of the KC-390 aircraft, which is, again, it's not an European program, it's a global program in which Portugal had an amazing role. It was the first time that we actually developed about 2/3 of the structure of this aircraft. It was the first time that Portugal had a meaningful, important role in an aeronautical program worldwide. And for that, it was not only the engineering, it was also the science, it was also the involvement of institutions like PIEP, like the University of Minho, but also institutions like OGMA, for example, which manufactured the parts, and SAIA, which developed themselves. So this is an example of a program which had multiple partners, a lot of challenges, and certainly made us enrich our knowledge, enrich our capabilities here in Portugal. And I believe that we should now take the next step and not only working for the big manufacturers, but have our own strategy on what we could do with the competencies, with the capabilities that we learned and that we acquired over the last few years in developing the KC-390 transport aircraft. Another challenge about micro launchers in this case, with the development of the kick stage and the payload fairings, which are very lightweight structures, composite structures, and which is an example of how we can mix the fact that we have a territory and an opportunity of launching satellites from middle of the Atlantic with also having a technology endeavor and also having our industries and our companies working towards this challenge of building a lightweight composite structure to launch small satellites into space. And finally, and Miguel already mentioned, an example on how, if we want, and Portugal is really, I'm using the correct words, if we want, because sometimes we don't, we can work together. And by working together is not only putting engineers to work together, is by putting engineers to work with medical staff, to work with health professionals, to work with universities, to work with researchers, to work with foundations, innovators, et cetera, and in how in 45 days we developed this medical invasive ventilator, the Athena, which we have up to date manufactured 400 units, and which we are now preparing to go towards the 900 units, and which we are now finishing a partnership with American company for them to take the exclusive fabrication and the exclusive retail of this product, which again, it was built for a challenge that we were facing here at the country, but it can target and it is competitive as well in the global markets. And finally, I do not like recipes, and I only have 3 more slides, so I'll be very fast. How to bridge the gap between science and industry, and by industry, I mean economy in a post-pandemic world. And I have, well, to make a cake, you have multiple ingredients. I have 3 which I consider can be core ingredients of this strategy. And I'll give concrete examples, because I also don't like to be a tourist. One is we need to keep on reindustrializing our country. We have the workforce, we have the people, we have the capabilities. We need to keep on improving towards high value chains. We need to keep on improving towards highly competitive products. And a good example would be to take the knowledge that we built with the KC-390, to take the capabilities that we have on the aeronautical cluster, and to target a new complex aeronautical problem, but one that we can go end to end. One that we, as a small country with the capabilities that we have, can really achieve completely. And obviously that is not a big aircraft. It's what we call a short distances aircraft. It's a multifunctional lightweight aircraft that we call the ATL. And that we believe that together in the country, we can really develop this aircraft and we can really target it towards developing countries and countries that are now growing and have a need for these vehicles like Africa or like Brazil and South America, for example. So we need to work not only this platform from an economic perspective and technology perspective, but also make it so that in the future it can be carbon neutral. So we need to think about how to make it green, and that means not only conventional propulsion, but also electric propulsion and so on. Then the second one, and this is addressing already what the minister mentioned this morning, we need to become more sustainable. We need to build a sustainable future. Okay, we need to care about the economy, we need to care about ourselves and our day-to-day, but we need to leave something for our children of tomorrow, and that's a sustainable future. And if we don't make this, well, then there is no tomorrow. And for that, I suggest that we start with targeting zero carbon mobility ecosystems. And target zero carbon mobility ecosystems means twofold. In one hand, it means having vehicles, platforms, bicycles, cars, trucks, logistics, which are greener, which are zero carbon emission, which are fully electric or which can be hydrogen based, but we need to change. We need to diminish the number of vehicles in our cities, and we need to diminish their impact on carbon. And the second one is really to have the platforms and the means to quantify what we are avoiding, to quantify how much carbon we are sparing, to quantify and to provide information to our citizens on the data of their sole contribute and of the contribute of a city, of a region, of a country as a whole, because we'll need to have indicators on our evolution, and these platforms will be a key factor for citizens, for countries, and for regions to contribute. And finally, the third one, and Miguel and Ricardo already mentioned, I think we need to strengthen our Atlantic position. Our Atlantic position and our Atlantic Ocean, the Portuguese Atlantic, is something that is of unique value. And I'm saying here that to strengthen our Atlantic position, we need to value our ocean of data, because it's really what's out there. It's an ocean of data. It's an ocean of information. And those data and those information will, in a first hand, they will help building our future, because they will give us knowledge that will help us understand climate changes, that will help us understand the ecosystems, monitor the ecosystems, have sovereignty over these areas. But in the other hand, there is a huge opportunity on how to take sustainable value out of the ocean. And that means industry, that means offshore renewables, that means aquaculture, that means mineration, that means many, many things that we cannot exploit before we know, before we understand. So one cannot come without the other. And for that, obviously, I do agree that having an Atlantic satellite constellation is one of the root bases for us to really grow this, and we can only complement this constellation with the other in-situ observation platforms. But Portugal would definitely grow if it could organize ourselves, if it could follow the lead of the Earth Center and build this constellation so that we can strengthen our position. And the constellation is not something that can only be born with the country, so that would have to make us collaborate with European partners, but also global partners across the ocean. And finally, my last slide, I really strongly believe that we learned a huge lesson from the COVID-19 pandemic. And by we, I mean not only the citizens, the regulators, the scientists, the companies, the industries. We learned that together, and if we want, if we learn to collaborate, which is something very difficult, we can really have an impact using science, technology, and innovation at the basis. So I think there are three things that we need to start doing for this to be sustainable and for us to recover from this pandemic with science, technology, and innovation. One is we need to build policies to innovate which are stable in the long term. Innovation takes time, takes persistence, takes effort, and this effort and this persistence and our goals and our priorities cannot change with our governments. They need to be kept in the long term. So this is clear, this is something that we need. Then we need to recognize that to strengthen Europe's global position, we shall first find our role. We shall first find what can we do. We shall first find our core areas. And we cannot do everything. We need to focus. And that's something that normally we tend to disperse funding so that everyone is happy, but that in the end, we only have so-so, and we end up on not doing or not reaching the full potential of what we could do. So for that, I believe we should start by establishing our strengths, we should start by identifying our priorities, and we should keep on joining our efforts. And for that, I think the COVID-19 really gave us a lesson, but now we have to keep on doing that, and we need to keep on further developing what we did with science, technology, and innovation towards a more global Europe, but above all towards a more sustainable country, because without a sustainable country, we will never be able to contribute to a more global Europe. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Tiago. Very nice presentation. You cover so many aspects. So I retained some ideas. Say it wants to fill the gap between academia and the industry. The answer from Saya to the pandemic crisis with the ventilators, it was really amazing how in almost 2 months they got these ventilators. Also, the same contribution to comprehensive oceans, gathering more data, produce information, running services, and of course, the long-term policies for innovation, because innovation takes time. Now I will pass the floor to Dr. Firoz Rasool. So Dr. Firoz Rasool is the president of Chief Executive Officer of Aga Khan University. Please.
Thank you very much for the invitation and the fascinating presentations that preceded. I'm going to speak about something a little bit different. I'm going to speak about the response to COVID. This was a suggestion from Minister Manuel Haitor and my trustee, Professor Antonio Rendas, who suggested that to give a perspective from outside Portugal, particularly from parts of Africa and Asia, on how a private institutional network dealt with COVID and what are the things that we had to deal with. Many of you are aware of the Aga Khan Development Network because of its presence in Portugal, and the Aga Khan University that I represent is part of that network. And so today I'm grateful for the invitation to speak about the experience that we have had. So let me give you a little bit of a context. I hope you can see these graphs. They basically show the countries that we are in Kenya, Pakistan, Afghanistan, in Uganda. So you can see the cumulative cases since February to October 27th, which is when this particular chart was presented. Now, these cases are per million people. So that just gives you an idea, and I will give you some comparison in a second. And this is the number of deaths. So if you take Pakistan, the number of deaths is 30 per million. Kenya is 20 per million, just to give you an idea. Now, I accept that in parts of the developing world, collecting data sometimes can be more difficult. But this is data that has been collected from an international source and validated by them. So then as we continue, I've compared here UK and Portugal, because we have a presence in both UK and Portugal here. And it gives you an idea. So the number of cases we're looking at is 10,000 per million people. As you can see the graph on the right, it gives you a sense of where we are. And then if you look at UK and Portugal, in terms of deaths per million people, remember I said Pakistan was 30 and Kenya was 20. UK is over 700 per million, and Portugal is something like 250. So it gives you a sense, and we need to understand what exactly is going on. So here are some other epidemiological data. You can see total cases in Pakistan, 300,000 and over. And deaths about 6,700 total. Population 220 million, just to give you an idea. Kenya's population is about 50 million, about 50,000 cases and 950 deaths. And here's the data for Portugal that you're familiar with, about 150,000 cases, of which about 2,600 deaths. So just to give you a sense of scale. And of course, the population of Portugal is much, much smaller than some of the countries that we are talking about. And this is the UK, about a million cases and 46,000 deaths so far. So this is what COVID did. It, as everybody knows, something unprecedented. It came and hit. This is another country we're in, Afghanistan. And you can see the number of deaths is about 1,600 now. You could argue that it's not enough testing and so on, but we can tell by deaths in the hospital. You don't have to worry about testing, and the reporting of data is, while not perfectly equal to the West, it's pretty good. So how did we deal with this at the Aga Khan University? So this just gives you an idea about some of the tests we had to set up and perform. These are some of the patients that were admitted to our hospitals, and you can see the peak was in July, and now we are beginning to see a second peak coming up. But the impact for us, as in many hospitals, I visited the hospital Curi Cabral yesterday and met with the people there. The first was that the other patients disappeared. They didn't want to be in the same hospital as the COVID patients because they didn't know what this COVID was. Do you catch it by walking in a hallway? If you're in the same room, what happens? So people didn't want to come. And that affected for us as a private, not-for-profit hospital system, our revenues in a big, big way. Also, we had some employees who were infected, but we found out they were more infected in where they lived, in the community, than in the hospital. That reduced our capacity. People were tired, they were fearful, they were anxious. We had to transition to online learning, as many universities did. And the question was, what was the role of our medical and nursing students in the pandemic? Do we bring them to the hospital? Do we ask them to stay home? Do we get them involved? Are we putting them in danger? I mean, all of these questions were ones that existed. Here's a, for those of you who visited our campus, this is our waiting area during COVID. And this is our waiting area before COVID. So just shows you how the patients all disappeared. So what was our response? So we're just going to play a video here. Okay, it's coming up.
After the hospital received its first COVID patient in late February, our whole world changed. We had to work around the clock to rapidly create the facilities for handling a high number of infected patients.
So now we are taking you to the COVID unit.
We converted the 10-bedded acute care unit into a state-of-the-art negative pressure facility. We've converted our emergency department spaces to ensure that we are able to handle all patients, including COVID patients, safely. We've also converted the old private wing into a COVID diagnostic and treatment zone. This involves numerous modifications, including creation of dawning doffing areas, airlock systems at the entrances to ensure that the corridors and the spaces outside of this are safe and secure. A state-of-the-art testing and screening site is now up and about. This testing facility is the first of its kind in Pakistan. The last 2 months for us has been a learning experience, a journey which has been long, difficult, but yet full of hope.
So you just saw that we had to set up very quickly testing facilities that were separated from the rest of the hospitals. And this was a booth that we built. So we protected the person taking the test from the patient or person coming for tests. This gives you an idea. It had to be done all outdoors because that was the advice at the time. Keep people outside in fresh air that's moving all the time. We had to build field hospitals. So these were temporary isolation facilities. This was built in a sports pavilion in Nairobi. This is also in Nairobi. This is the current version of an American military field hospital. And the American government donated this hospital to us. It takes care of 40 patients with full ICU facilities, operating theaters, and everything else. This is the inside of this field hospital, just to give you an idea. This is the field hospital in Karachi, in Pakistan, in an expo center, not unlike this one, which was converted into a field hospital. And we had to reassign staff to critical areas to make sure we had the people, not just the spaces. Of course, training and guidelines for personal protective equipment was extremely important. And that, these are all the things that many people had to go through. But for us in the developing world to be able to have to deal with this was a big challenge. So what did we learn? We obviously had to go to online and distance learning for our classes with our students. We are now bringing students back gradually, particularly the medical students and the nursing students in their fourth and fifth year for their clinical training. So that has just begun. Of course, we have gone to blended learning, a mix of online and in-person learning so that our students don't fall behind in their education. We also had to protect employees through providing proper spaces. We had to modify the spaces. Here's the areas that we created physical distancing in classes, in waiting areas, outside. Many of our people are working from home. For us, this is a pretty challenging situation. Why is it challenging? In countries where we work, the internet is very unreliable, and power is not available all the time. So how do you teach a student or ask a teacher to deliver a course when the internet is down most of the day? And if the internet is up, then the power is down. And so those are some of the challenges that we've had to deal with. We also created a lot of apps. So this is an app we created that every student and every employee has to do a self-screening before they come to the campus. And it's very simple. It's like a traffic light. If you put the symptoms in, how you feel and so on, if it's red, you don't come in. If it's yellow, you go for a test. And if it's green, you come in. And so that's how we are still managing the process of bringing people back to campus. And you can see some of the safety measures. Of course, training of the staff, extremely important. And for us, it's not just training the staff, but it's also retaining the staff. I'll give you an idea. With the UK now leaving the EU through Brexit, is losing a lot of European healthcare workers. So guess what? They're recruiting nurses in Kenya. So all these nurses that we have trained in ICU practices and so on, we are losing them now. They're paying four times the amount of money, and this is now a massive brain drain in the middle of a crisis that's begun. We also had to get involved in innovating, and we saw some examples of this. So here's an example of a UV light that we created to disinfect PPEs, masks in particular, for our doctors, so they can be reused. And we've got a patent for it that we have just applied for this UV disinfection machine. Here's the app I was telling you about that every employee and every student has that we had to develop. And we also developed an app, we call this the Corona Check, for six countries, for the population, so they can look at their health condition. So it was for Kenya, Uganda, Tanzania, Tajikistan, Afghanistan, and Pakistan. And so they use this app in different languages. It gives you an idea about the type of things. Also, for us to buy product was very difficult. So this is a simple nasal swab that is critical for the testing of COVID. We couldn't buy it. You can't access it, not in the developing world, because I don't know if you're aware, 92 of the 95 countries that produce medical supplies have a no export rule. So Portugal can't export unless they get approval from the government. And particularly when you have these types of devices we created our own. These are 3D printed right in our lab now, because we had to develop our own production facility. You heard about ventilators. We used this, we shared ventilators between two patients, and we had to modify the manifolds and so on. We had to produce in-house sanitizer, because you couldn't import any. You couldn't buy any. We had to develop our own. So this just gives you an idea. And to give you a broader idea in terms of the research, we have now undertaken almost 150 studies under different disciplines. They go obviously from epidemiology and clinical, but also to healthcare-related, health worker-related, and mental health-related, because mental health is a big challenge in this particular crisis that doesn't come through. We're doing a study of the genomic diversity of the virus in Pakistan, and looking at through next-generation sequencing. We're doing this with the NIH in the US. We're also looking at the markers of disease severity through gene expression in asymptomatic patients to be able to get some idea. And this is funded by the Pakistan Higher Education. Here's a partnership with Portugal, with University of Lisbon, and with Nova University, and looking at immunity through immunological assays that we've begun. And this is a joint project with Portugal. We're also looking at surveillance of patients to look for the spread of infection in the province where we are. And we've also been developing drugs to treat patients in this particular area, particularly to do with pregnant women and young children that have just been given given birth. The mothers have given birth, and the mother might have COVID. And what about the child? And this was a very interesting analysis, that the second, which is looking at the burden and the epidemiology and mitigation strategies in majority Muslim countries. Many of the Muslim countries don't have their own national public health agencies, and they are not able to respond, some of the poorer ones particularly. So we did a comparative study of what is available across the world and what the result has been. A couple of areas that I think you might be interested, we're also testing two COVID-19 vaccines. One is a Chinese vaccine made by a company called CanSino, which is now in clinical trials right now in Karachi. And we also did the Empecta study with Roche in the US, and a clinical trial on this drug, tocilizumab, which is made by Roche Genentech for African patients, because they have been testing these drugs in other parts of the world, but when they came to Africa, they needed an FDA-approved clinical trial center, which is what we have. We are the only FDA-approved clinical trial center in sub-Saharan Africa. And so this is where we are testing these drugs with Genentech. Convalescent plasma, of course, is every country is testing this, and we are as well. And we are also starting in Nairobi, in Kenya, this clinical trial on the vaccine from Sanofi to look at whether these vaccines are going to work in different populations. So this is an international trial that we are part of, and we are doing the Africa or the Asia section of this particular one. And of course, the constant surveillance trials that we need to do in looking at the infection. Finally, I just wanted to add by saying that in many of these countries, the governments don't have the capacity, and we have to advise them on management of care, best practice, even supplies. We talked about nasal swabs that we had to create. This is a very interesting project. I'll just take a minute to explain. There is a massive shortage of ICU capacity in the countries where we work. So in Pakistan, there are very few ICU facilities, but even fewer ICU doctors and nurses and technicians. So what we did is, working with the Gates Foundation, who funded this, and then a local foundation who came forward with this, is we set up a national tele-ICU project. So we connected all the ICUs to Aga Khan University, so we can support a doctor in 2,000 kilometers away with a patient who is now going down fast. How do you treat them? And not only that, we connected our alumni, all of our graduates who are in the US. So we had 1,000 doctors and nurses all connected by telehealth 24 hours a day to help any hospital in any village or small town, and a doctor who needed help with ICU support for the patients. In Kenya, we helped the Ministry of Health, and we also provided technical support and, of course, clinical data that they need for their studies. So what happens next? This is the next question. The virus hasn't gone away. It's still here. We are seeing a second wave, a third wave. So what happens next? And this is the question we have started to look at. Of course, telehealth is one that has already begun, where people who don't want to come to the hospital, we are now beginning to treat them through using telemedicine. Home health has become a very important area. So pharmacies, medicines to be delivered, we are now delivering them to people's homes, so they don't have to leave their homes. We're also doing home health services, physiotherapy, blood collection, and whatever, you know, portable ultrasound machines we have, we are also using that so people who either choose not to or are unable to leave home, that can be treated at home. So what are the lessons we learned, and what are the questions? The first one is, what are the factors that underlie this anomaly in Pakistan? Why is it Pakistan, with 220 million people, has only 30 deaths per million? And Portugal has 250, and the UK has 750. Why? Is it genetic? We don't know. We don't think so, because some of the doctors in the UK, most of the doctors in the UK who are dying are South Asian. So how does that explain? It's a big quiz. We don't understand that. The other question is, with infection and mortality, what are the differences between India and Pakistan? They're genetically the same. And yet, two countries side by side, big differences. We don't understand what that is. As you can see, I said also, why are the death rates of South Asians much higher in the West than in the East? Not understood. What are the reasons underlying the ethnic differences in infections locally and globally? This is an area for new research. The other one is, what is the immune response to the virus? Why is it so different across the world? So are the means vaccines are going to be more efficacious in some countries than others? We don't know. What are the factors that cause the diversity in phenotypical expression of disease? Short-term versus long, is it age-related, environmental-related, demography-related? Don't know the answer to some of these questions. And what is the probability and mechanism for reinfection? When will the antibodies die down? When the patient becomes exposed? If this is flu-like, then does that mean we need a vaccination or a vaccine inoculation every year? Again, lots of questions unanswered. So I'm going to leave you with those unanswered questions and to say there are areas of collaboration and participation with our partners, including in Portugal, for some of these questions, and we hope to work together to understand the underlying area. One thing is clear, that has become clear in my visit to Lisbon this week, is that this new disease has leveled the playing field between the developing world and the developed world. Institutions in the developing world have an equal chance of creating new knowledge and a new understanding about a pathogen that is completely devastating the world as the countries in the developed world, in Europe, in the US, and in China, and elsewhere. So we are excited. Of course, we are terrified of also what the unknown looks like. But we're excited with what we think we can might be able to contribute. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Razul. I will finish now this session, but before I want just to retain some ideas about the session. So I just want to start with summarizing what the Minister of Economy just said. We need to put the science and knowledge into the economy. Then myself, I mentioned also the credibility of the political decisions based on the science and the advisors of the science. Alexandre pointed to have more data, more science databases, and easy access to those databases. Miguel stated the importance to have more data by satellites, the needs to have models like the digital twin earths, digital planets, and also to tackle the problems of our sustainability focus on the Atlantic. And Tiago from SEIA mentioned wants to fill the gap between academia and the industry, get more data, produce information, analytics, and also running services. And he points out also the long-term policies for innovations, and innovation takes time. And finally, Dr. Razul present us the response and their experience, the response for the COVID, an overview of the pandemic profile, and also their learning experience and new methods, and of course, new self-manufacturers internally to respond to their needs. So, I think now we have to conclude this session, the intervention by video of the Minister of Foreign Affairs, Augusto Santos Silva. I think this is the moment to pass the video, right? Okay.
Bom dia a todos.
Bom dia a
todos. Começo em primeiro lugar por agradecer o convite para participar mais uma vez no Encontro de Ciência, neste caso o Encontro de Ciência 2020. Sabem todos o gosto com que o faço. Peço desculpa de não poder estar presencialmente, mas é por razões relativas à minha própria agenda, que me impedem de estar em Portugal e em Lisboa nesta ocasião. E queria apresentar a minha comunicação, estruturando-a em quatro pontos fundamentais. No primeiro ponto, procurarei explicar a importância que a internacionalização da ciência e da tecnologia tem para a política europeia e externa do nosso país. Em segundo lugar, queria entrar no ponto fundamental desta sessão, que é a importância da ciência para a Europa global e, portanto, queria enquadrar o que nós fazemos no domínio da ciência e tecnologia nas nossas responsabilidades como Estado-membro da União Europeia e, em particular, como a próxima presidência do Conselho da União Europeia. Em terceiro lugar, queria mostrar quão importante a dimensão científica é na relação bilateral e na cooperação bilateral de Portugal com outros países. E, finalmente, queria argumentar que a ciência, a investigação, o ensino superior, portanto, em geral, o mundo académico, representa um dos planos mais importantes da cooperação, da política de cooperação para o desenvolvimento desenvolvida por Portugal. Comecemos, portanto, pelo primeiro ponto, mais genérico, apenas para recordar que tenho defendido que a internacionalização deve ser entendida como um dos objetivos estratégicos da política europeia e externa de Portugal, juntamente com a nossa participação na construção europeia, a nossa ligação atlântica, com a nossa ligação particular com os países de língua portuguesa, com a nossa ligação ainda mais particular com as comunidades portuguesas espalhadas pelo mundo e com a nossa vinculação básica, fundamental ao multilateralismo, juntamente, portanto, com todas estas orientações estratégicas, a internacionalização deve ser tomada também como uma linha de força fundamental da nossa política. E quando digo internacionalização, não falo apenas da internacionalização da economia, não falo apenas da internacionalização da língua e da cultura, falo também da internacionalização da ciência e da tecnologia, desde logo do nosso Sistema Nacional de Ciência e Tecnologia. É muito importante nós compreendermos que é internacional o quadro de referência do nosso próprio Sistema de Ciência e Tecnologia, como é muito importante também termos bem consciência da capacidade do recurso estratégico para o país que é o seu sistema de ciência e tecnologia, como é igualmente importante percebermos o papel que a diplomacia científica tem na política europeia e externa. E é, portanto, desta perspectiva geral que valoriza a internacionalização da ciência e da tecnologia portuguesa que eu gostaria de abordar agora os três pontos específicos que, como já disse, escolhi para falar hoje: as nossas responsabilidades europeias, o papel da ciência nas nossas relações bilaterais e o papel da ciência na nossa política de cooperação. Comecemos, portanto, pela Europa. A ciência terá um papel essencial na recuperação da economia europeia, na economia pós-Covid, porque tanto ansiamos. E com a consciência que todos temos, ou devemos ter, de que a recuperação da economia portuguesa, da economia europeia, digo, será ao mesmo tempo um processo de transformação da economia europeia, para torná-la mais resiliente e para torná-la mais adaptada aos desafios do tempo de hoje, em particular ao desafio do que nós chamamos a dupla transição, a transição digital de um lado e a transição verde do outro. E, evidentemente, que essa transição verde e digital, nós só podemos vencê-la se mobilizarmos os recursos científicos e tecnológicos de que dispomos. E, portanto, o meu primeiro argumento, a minha primeira hipótese de trabalho é esta, de pensarmos que o processo de recuperação e transformação da economia europeia em que estamos agora envolvidos e para o qual vamos mobilizar recursos financeiros como nunca antes tínhamos feito, esse processo exige uma maior incorporação tecnológica dos nossos produtos e processos e exige uma maior base científica, uma mais larga base científica para esses processos e produtos. E isto materializa-se em certas iniciativas e certas responsabilidades que marcarão de uma forma muito clara a presidência portuguesa do Conselho da União Europeia no próximo semestre, entre janeiro e junho de 2021. Desde logo, por causa do lançamento dos novos programas no quadro do novo quadro financeiro plurianual, que são programas que têm diretamente a ver com esta área. O novo programa Erasmus, de mobilidade académica, o novo programa Horizonte Europa, que terá maior dimensão e maior fôlego, e o programa Europeu para o Espaço. É a primeira vez que ele vai ser lançado e vai ser lançado na nossa presidência pela primeira vez a partir de 2021. Haverá um programa europeu para o espaço. Também queria chamar a atenção, se me permitem, para os avanços muito substanciais que vão ocorrer no próximo ano no que diz respeito à Europa digital. Em 2021 iniciar-se-á a década digital europeia, 2021-2030, e isso não se trata apenas de uma agenda de promessas ou de compromissos. Trata-se de uma agenda de iniciativas e de realizações. Está hoje adquirido que será no primeiro semestre do próximo ano que se lançará, que se concluirá, que se efetivará, melhor dizendo, o novo cabo submarino que ligará a Europa e a América Latina e que na Europa será amarrado em Sines, e é muito possível que o primeiro supercomputador europeu verde seja lançado também durante a nossa presidência. E, portanto, o sistema europeu de processamento de dados, o papel da Europa na chamada ciência dos dados, será mais claro, mais intenso, mais forte no próximo ano e, evidentemente, que isso coloca novas responsabilidades à presidência portuguesa do Conselho da União Europeia, mas também à comunidade científica e tecnológica portuguesa no seu conjunto. E depois não esqueçamos as responsabilidades que já são hoje as nossas em várias agências científicas internacionais muito importantes. Começando pela Europa, foi com todo o gosto que nós vimos o nosso compatriota, engenheiro Rodrigo da Costa, ser escolhido, depois de um processo muito competitivo e exigente, ser escolhido para diretor executivo da Agência Europeia do Sistema Global de Navegação por Satélite. E esse nosso compatriota terá uma responsabilidade na transformação qualitativa dessa agência, que se perfilará no próximo futuro. Depois, Portugal ocupa neste momento, juntamente com a França, a presidência do Conselho da Agência Europeia do Espaço. Depois, Portugal criou o Air Center, uma iniciativa intergovernamental com sede no arquipélago dos Açores, na região autónoma dos Açores, na Ilha Terceira, que junta esforços de 14 países europeus, africanos, latino-americanos e de várias organizações científicas e universitárias. E, portanto, as nossas responsabilidades europeias e internacionais no domínio científico são evidentes, já são hoje grandes e serão maiores no próximo futuro. E, evidentemente, este é um contributo nosso para uma Europa mais global e, com ela, um sistema científico e tecnológico português mais internacionalizado. Mas eu queria aproveitar os minutos que me restam para me referir ainda a outros dois pontos que reputo igualmente importantes. O primeiro é o papel da ciência no relacionamento bilateral. Vamos fazer um pequeno exercício exemplificativo. Olhemos para as relações bilaterais com os nossos vizinhos. Nós temos dois vizinhos. Temos um vizinho que nos liga a contiguidade territorial por terra, a Espanha, e, neste momento, o grande projeto comum conjunto luso-espanhol que existe, está consolidado e se desenvolve cada ano que passa, é um projeto na área da ciência e da tecnologia. Estou-me a referir ao Instituto de Nanotecnologia, sediado em Braga. A cooperação bilateral Portugal e Espanha não seria hoje a mesma se não houvesse o Instituto de Nanotecnologia, e esse instituto foi o primeiro grande projeto conjunto que os dois países se abalançaram a fazer, e não foi por acaso que esse primeiro grande projeto conjunto se fez na área da ciência mais avançada e da tecnologia de ponta. E agora olhemos para o outro vizinho do outro lado, um vizinho que é nosso vizinho do outro lado do Atlântico, os Estados Unidos. O programa científico, em muito boa hora, lançado pelo saudoso José Mariano Gago, revolucionou, eu acho que o verbo é mesmo esse, revolucionou o quadro de relacionamento bilateral entre Portugal e os Estados Unidos. Estou-me a referir aos programas de intercâmbio e de cooperação universitária e científica de universidades portuguesas e instituições americanas que são líderes a nível mundial, como a Harvard Medical School, o Massachusetts Institute of Technology, o famosíssimo MIT, o MIT, a Carnegie Mellon ou a Universidade de Texas em Houston. O programa consistente, lógico, coerente de trabalho entre universidades e instituições de investigação portuguesas e universidades e instituições de investigação americanas mudou e mudou qualitativamente a substância e também, digamos, o nível, a escala do relacionamento bilateral entre Portugal e os Estados Unidos. São apenas dois exemplos, outros poderia dar sobre a importância da ciência na nossa relação bilateral com a Alemanha, por exemplo, e muitos outros países, mas estes exemplos bastam, na minha opinião, para percebermos bem a importância que a ciência tem na política externa portuguesa. E, finalmente, o papel da ciência em sentido lato, portanto, formação avançada, investigação científica, inovação, aplicação tecnológica, o papel que a ciência, em sentido lato, tem na nossa política de cooperação. A nossa política de cooperação tem, naturalmente, parceiros privilegiados, os países africanos de língua portuguesa e Timor-Leste, e, nesse quadro, a dimensão da formação avançada e da investigação é crucial. E é cada vez mais crucial. Dou apenas alguns exemplos. Em primeiro lugar, a importância que detém no conjunto dos programas de cooperação a dimensão da formação avançada. Nós temos um programa de bolsas através do nosso Instituto Camões diretamente e através também de outras instituições, desde logo as ligadas às Forças Armadas e às Forças e Serviços de Segurança. Nós temos um programa de bolsas, dizia, que tem uma componente interna e uma componente externa. A componente interna quer dizer bolsas para a realização de estudos nos respectivos países financiadas pela cooperação portuguesa, e a externa quer dizer bolsas para que estudantes de ensino superior dos países africanos de língua portuguesa ou de Timor-Leste disponham para estudarem e se formarem em Portugal. Essas bolsas apoiam a realização de estudos de graduação, de licenciatura ou de pós-graduação ao nível de mestrado ou doutoramento. E são uma componente muito importante, por razões que me dispenso de explicitar, da nossa cooperação. Mas não são a única componente. É também muito importante o trabalho que nós temos feito através do Ministério da Ciência, Tecnologia e Ensino Superior, e que é um trabalho de cooperação nossa com redes internacionais de apoio ao desenvolvimento para favorecer, para capacitar mais a nossa cooperação na área da ciência e do ensino superior com países africanos de língua portuguesa. Um exemplo muito interessante é o exemplo da cooperação entre o Ministério da Ciência, Tecnologia e Ensino Superior Português e a rede HK para o desenvolvimento, de que têm beneficiado justamente países africanos que são nossos parceiros na cooperação. E, finalmente, queria referir-me aos programas, projetos de cooperação que são inteiramente científicos, são projetos de natureza científica. Um, talvez o mais consolidado até ao momento, mas um muito conhecido, é o Centro de Investigação em Saúde em Angola, o CISA, que tem sido, ao longo dos anos, um dos projetos bandeira da cooperação portuguesa e que é, como o nome indica, um projeto de capacitação de Angola em recursos científicos e de investigação na área da biologia e das ciências biomédicas. Outros exemplos se poderiam dar em Moçambique e noutros países parceiros. O meu ponto com estes exemplos é apenas este. É mostrar que a ciência e a formação avançada são uma dimensão muito importante, um pilar muito importante da política de cooperação portuguesa. Portanto, resumindo, este movimento de internacionalização da nossa ciência é também um movimento de protagonismo dos nossos recursos, programas e projetos científicos no quadro europeu e internacional. Seja pela presença que nós temos nos programas e nas instituições europeias e pelas novas responsabilidades que vamos ter com a nossa presidência do Conselho da União Europeia, seja no relacionamento bilateral com outros países, seja nesse relacionamento específico que é aquele favorecido e enquadrado nos programas de cooperação para o desenvolvimento. Desejo um bom trabalho a todos.